Today we are talking about a particularly nice application of our loop antenna. And this episode is not only interesting for amateur radio astronomers, but certainly for all fans of wireless communication. I'm very happy about the pioneering spirit of two amateur astronomers who built our loop antenna for their amateur radio telescope. By the way, we were getting in touch through a comment on one of our earlier videos. So it might be worth subscribing to the channel, and if you have any question, don't hesitate to write them in the comments. Our original idea was improving the interference resilience of Wi-Fi, LoRa, Zigbee, Bluetooth, etc. using a frequency selective antenna. Furthermore, we discovered additional advantages of this antenna principle in previous videos. Hey, this is exactly what we need as a feed antenna for our amateur radio telescope. Maybe that was on Ekkehard's mind, and then he decided to build the loop antenna. He dimensioned the antenna for the 1420.4 MHz hydrogen frequency using our Excel tool. The hydrogen radiation is revealing information about the density, distribution, speed and temperature of hydrogen atoms in the universe. Here is the dimensioning for the construction made of 3.6 mm copper wire, and here is an alternative design made from copper plate. Our Excel tool is comprising even more interesting designs. Feel free to watch the videos. But what is actually the advantage for an amateur radio telescope? Let's take a quick look at the concept and the setup. A parabolic antenna is ideal to scan the sky because of its good directivity. You need a receiver, optionally a controlled rotor, and a PC plus software to record the signals. As the signals are weak, a 30 dB low noise amplifier close to the antenna is used, and the bandpass is filtering out the desired frequency band. Next, the signal is amplified to compensate for the cable attenuation of the long cable to the receiver. The thickness of the arrow shall represent the signal strength simplified. On that path, there are also interfering signals. There is broadband noise, which is caused by components of the antenna and electronics, and we are receiving unwanted signals that are amplified by the broadband LNA as well. A large part of that noise is cut by the bandpass, and finally the narrowband receiver is filtering the wanted signal. There is also man-made noise caused by mobile phones, strong broadcast stations, etc. That would not be a problem actually, since the frequencies could be filtered out. However, strong signals are driving the LNA to its limits, causing intermodulation products. All of a sudden, noise and hundreds of signals can superimpose our wanted signal, even though they are not actually present in the air. What can we do about it? A frequency selective antenna avoids the LNA being modulated by strong signals in the neighboring frequency bands. You're even achieving a disproportionate improvement, because the amplitude of the intermodulation products is increasing and decreasing with the third power in relation. In other words, our loop antenna is reducing the signal amplitudes on the neighboring bands, and thus intermodulation products are dropping rapidly. In this context, third-order intermodulation products are usually dominant, but in theory, any mixed product could cause trouble. I'm demonstrating this in the 866 MHz band, bringing my receiver antennas close to a ESP32 development board. I turned up the gain of my SDR receiver to the max in order to provoke intermodulation. The Bluetooth adapter of the ESP32 board is certainly strong enough to drive the receiver input stage to its limits. So we are expecting intermodulation products from Bluetooth, the processor clock and digital signals. I'm comparing a J-pole antenna with our loop antenna. With the loop antenna, the amplitudes of the interfering signals are smaller and we are seeing less peaks in the received spectrum. So, in practice, we can expect significantly less interference applying the loop. In my experiment, the interference disappears completely with the loop in half a meter distance, while it is still present with the J-pole antenna. Applying a 30 dB LNA, we can expect intermodulation up to 10 meters distance caused from this device. Applying the loop, that no-go area becomes significantly smaller. The radiation characteristics of the simple loop would not be suitable as a feed antenna, because it needs to fit the parabolic mirror. Similar to other feed antennas, we can install the loop in a pod where the bottom is a reflector and the wall is shielding from the side. That might fit somehow, but we would like to quantify this, simulating the antenna including the pod as a wire grid model. Both the azimuth and the elevation diagram have a 3D beamwidth of about 56 degrees, so the three-dimensional radiation pattern is almost rotation symmetric. At a beamwidth of 120 degrees, corresponding to the aperture of the parabolic mirror, the radiation from the feeder has dropped well below minus 10 dB. So, almost the complete radiation is reaching the feeder. In reality, the side lobes are smaller because a wire grid model is more permeable to electromagnetic waves than a conducting surface. Our amateur radio astronomers are even using a second, larger pod, which further reduces the side lobes caused by the pod rim's edge diffraction. Good, but wait a minute, we need to examine the antenna diagram in the neighboring frequency bands where interfering signals can appear. In the frequency range down to 500 MHz, everything looks very good, and below, the antenna receives practically nothing anyway, as we know. At higher frequencies, however, it doesn't look quite as good. At 2.5 GHz, the antenna gain is a few dB lower, but the diagram widens out and we are receiving signals from the side. That's why you better should avoid Wi-Fi, mobile radio, etc. close to the antenna. Anyway, I think the new antenna design could work very well, since it is resilient against intermodulation. I'm really happy about that particularly nice application of our loop antenna. The first feedback on the performance was pretty good. We are eager to see the first measurement results. Let's see, maybe we will find even more applications for the antenna. Now stay tuned and don't forget to support the channel. See you soon in the coming episodes.